How secure is email? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Ask Leo is brought to you in part by my patrons. askleo.com/patron has more information about how you can help and get access to patron-only benefits. Dive right into the question. My boss requires the emailing of some sensitive information on a regular basis. I've spoken with my boss and coworkers about all of us using an encrypted email system, but no one seems to think there is a significant threat or danger out there to require these extra steps in security. Can you offer any data to help me convince them that this is a good idea? Well, no, I don't have any hard data to say one way or the other. I do know that email encryption turns out to be surprisingly difficult, but on the other hand, the email system was designed in a simpler time, and data privacy, security, hiding your data, and sending sensitive information via email, honestly, wasn't really baked in. And that means that adding it as an afterthought, as we want to do, can be kind of problematic. The risk honestly varies too much depending on who's communicating, what they're communicating, what systems they happen to be using, and of all things, the path between the two communicants. So let's think first about what I call the practical risk. Most people have an overinflated sense of risk for things that they don't understand. I get it. It makes total sense, certainly from an evolutionary point of view, but even from a technological point of view, it's certainly safer to assume the worst for something that you don't understand. And Lord knows, email is incredibly difficult to understand. Not the how do I send and receive emails, though that has its own level of complexity, but the behind the curtains magic that happens once you press send. How does that message make it from point A to point B? You or I probably don't have all the details, and that's fine. You shouldn't have to know. But when it comes to understanding the security of your email, it's really worth understanding just how many different places along the way your email might be exposed. The bottom line is that anybody that has access to the network, the networking equipment, your mail servers, or the PCs across which your message transmits has an opportunity to actually take a look at the message. That might include, for example, anyone with access to your machine. So if you have somebody else that can sign into your machine or can use your machine, it's a good chance they can see the email you've sent. Malware, that's just sort of an all-encompassing term for any malicious software that might land on your machine. And since I've said many times, malware can do anything, one of those anythings is, let's have a look at this guy's mail. Other machines on your network, maybe, and I have to say maybe because this is where it really starts to get down into the technical rat's nest of issues, right? Depending on how your email is transmitted from your machine out of your network to your router, it's possible that some other machines on your network could listen in. They could see what's transmitting across the wire, even if they're not involved in the conversation. So it's very, very similar to a Wi-Fi hotspot, which by definition, anybody within range can listen in to the radio communication that is the transmission of your email to your email server. Your ISP, I mean, they're providing you with this service almost by definition. That means they have to be able to see what it is you're doing, and they can. Your email provider, again, same story. They have to be able to understand your email in order to be able to handle it, to deal with it, to send it on to where it's supposed to go. Now, all of a sudden, we're talking about, you know what? The other side of this happens too. So your recipient's ISP, your recipient's email provider, your recipient's network, other machines on the recipient's network, the malware on your recipient's machine, and of course, anybody that might have access to your recipient's machine. All of these are, I'll just call them opportunities for an individual or an entity to have a look at the messages that are being transmitted between you and your recipient. Now, that sounds really scary because honestly, there's a lot of people involved. There's a lot of places where things can be exposed. I don't believe it's any cause for panic. Lord knows I rely on email every single day, and I don't panic. I know how many steps it goes through. But what I also know is that these servers, these services, the people who might be interested, they're too busy. I've said before that you and I just aren't that interesting. Nobody's out there scanning what we do with the hopes of finding out something about us. Could they? Of course, there's lots of things that could happen. But do they is the question. And my sense is, my very strong sense after having done this now for decades and transmitted a lot of honestly very sensitive information via email, is that in general, no. It's just not something that I spend a lot of worry about. The real risks, the risks that I want you to focus on the most, are at what I call the endpoints. You and your machine and your recipient and their machine. Getting things secure in between those two points, we'll talk about that in a minute. But making sure that your machine doesn't have malware, making sure that your machine, your email account is configured properly, that your machine is locked, that individuals can't just walk up to it and view your email. Those are the kinds of things that probably matter the most. And bonus, they're in your control. Those are the kinds of things you do have control over. Now, what if you are, quote unquote, that interesting? Right? I've said before, you and I aren't that interesting, but what if we are, right? What if for some reason we are? Well, then unfortunately, the answer boils down to encryption. That's where things start to get really, really confusing. And unfortunately, because there is, I don't want to call it a lack of standards, because there are standards, but there are three standards. The most common one, no encryption at all. The next one is probably SMIME, and the next one is probably PGP. Yes, you can use, you already are using probably the unencrypted one. You can look into encrypted services, but the problem is both you and your recipient must, and I have to say must, be using the same encrypted service in order for email encryption to work. That's typically not particularly practical. The fourth standard, and it's the one that a lot of attorneys seem to take, don't use email at all. Use a telephone call. Use something other than email, something where what you're saying isn't being recorded, and more importantly, what you're saying isn't necessarily being intercepted. Now, there are some what I'll call very pragmatic things that we probably don't even realize are alternatives to email. For example, my online brokerage, they will send me an email. But the email itself will have no sensitive information in it. It will say, hey, there's information in your account. Go over, log into it, and then we can show you what that sensitive information is. Then I go to their website, their HTTPS configured website, and I view the secure message, the information about my accounts, the whatever. That conversation between my browser and their website is point to point. There are no intermediaries examining the data because A, the data is encrypted. That's what HTTPS is all about. Only I can see it and only the brokerage can see it. Anybody in the middle, anybody who can successfully intercept the communication will see only encrypted garbage. Again, endpoints matter. If you've got malware on your machine, well, yeah, it could see the unencrypted data, but that's something that's in your control. Choosing to use an HTTPS connection to get messages from a provider or from a brokerage or a bank or a healthcare provider, that's the secure alternative to email. Email serves only as a completely open and unencrypted notification that you've got something to look at, and then you've got a secure way to go and examine the message that's being sent to you. Now, I do want to talk about encryption in email. Like I said, there are multiple different approaches. I'm not going to get into things like MIME or PGP because honestly, it's a lot more work than it's worth, and for the average user, for sure. And there are simple, conceptually simpler alternatives that don't rely necessarily on, you know, I could only send it to this person because he's using this kind of encryption. I can only send it to that person because they're using that kind of encryption. The approach that I take when I'm backed into a corner and I have to send an encrypted message using my normal email account is I will write my message as a document, a Word document, a plain text document, whatever. I will then zip it using 7-zip or some other zip utility with a password. That password encrypts the data, and I will then email that zip file as an attachment to my recipient. I'll then make sure that they also get the password, but usually through a different communication path, be it a telephone call, a text message, an instant message using some other service, whatever. But the point is that the encrypted data travels alone and encrypted, and the password travels separately so that the recipient, and only the recipient, can then decrypt the message and read it. Now, there is one more solution. And honestly, this is probably the solution I would find myself end up using more often these days. As it turns out, I have a ProtonMail account. ProtonMail, by definition, advertises itself as a completely encrypted email system, which is true to a point. It's true in the sense that when you send email from your ProtonMail account to another ProtonMail account, that email is encrypted. It's stored encrypted. The only time it's ever decrypted is when you're writing it or when they're reading it. ProtonMail can't even see the message. All they can see is the encrypted blob, which is pretty much exactly how you want encrypted mail to work. But what if you want to send to somebody that doesn't have a ProtonMail account? Well, they kind of do a couple of the combination of things that I've just been talking about. If you send an encrypted message to a non-ProtonMail email account, what gets sent to the recipient is not the message. What gets sent to the recipient is a message that says, you've got mail. You've got a message. Here's a link to that message. And that link goes to protonmail.com. That then allows ProtonMail to use an HTTPS connection to make sure that the conversation between your recipient and the ProtonMail servers are secure. And then your recipient still has to give the password for your encrypted mail, which you've, again, given to them via some other mechanism that will allow ProtonMail to then decrypt the message in order for them to be able to see it. But they're watching it, they're looking at it, they're reading it on a web page. They're not reading it via email. All they got via email was a notification there was a message. The message itself is displayed on a secure website, owned, operated, and secured by ProtonMail. And they can reply. They can actually hit reply, compose a message, again, all in the web interface, and send it back to you, usually with the same password or maybe an opportunity to set up another one. But the bottom line is that the encrypted message actually is never sent via email other than within the ProtonMail ecosystem. So that's probably the approach that I would take these days if even setting up, you know, a zip file is a little bit too much for you and or your recipient. I hope that helps. Like I said, exactly whether or not encryption is really needed in email, that's something that I can't answer because it varies much too much on the specifics of the situation and what I'll call the cost of failure. In other words, just how bad is it really if you're somebody actually does end up looking at this email. But there are alternatives. There are ways to get the message communicated securely. None of them are as streamlined or as simple as we might want them to be, but at least they exist. For updates, for related links, for comments and more, visit askleo.com/2458. I'm Leo Notenboom. This is askleo.com. Take care.